want, today we'll go around the room and introduce yourselves, so.
Hi, I'm Matt Klein.
Larry Roush, Los Angeles Cold Storage.
Carolyn Leslie, Asset Manager with Atlas Capital.
Bob Spineland, Inner City Arts.
Drew Bauer, Young's Market Company.
Mark Shemaine, Property Owner and Business Owner.
Trevor Kale with Chrysalis.
Joel Howard with Chrysalis.
Grace Davis with Chrysalis.
Brett Antman, King Crab Services.
Hi, Joel Hopkins, new Downtown District Director for Councilmember Jose Weezer.
Your turn. Lauren Schlau, Lauren Schlau Market Research and Consulting.
Harry Tash Chin, Business Owner and Property Owner.
Thank you all for coming. So, that'll be any public comments?
That's what I'd like to ask, is there any public comment? I don't have any request for it, but.
All right, so on that note, the people on the list, any motion?
I'll make a motion in 30 minutes.
In a second? So all favor for the minutes? Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Okay, wonderful. So, Joel, you got here at the right time, perfect time, so we're going to have you come on up, introduce yourself, and kind of tell us what's going on in the council district.
Hi, everyone, good morning. I'm officially 4 weeks in, so I am just getting my feet wet, but I wanted to make sure I swung by to make sure you guys all see my face, and I'm available for comments, discussion. We've got another meeting that I'm ready to this morning, but just wanted to really kind of just say hello, hear your issues. We do have Megan, who you guys might have met, is our field deputy. But really just kind of, again, getting my feet wet, want to listen, want to see how I can help facilitate in the area, and I'm going to pass around my cards, so if you want to just grab it, please feel free to email me. We're trying to be much more responsive, at least let you know that we've heard you, and then we'll try to work on the situation or whatever concern that you may have. And feel free to give me a holler. Other than that, have a great year.
Just a quick question, the organizational structure of the office, and who does what?
So I'm in charge of all of downtown.
All of downtown?
All of downtown, and I will be overseeing my two field deputies, which is Megan and Lily. Megan, you should know, and if you don't, you will. And she is in charge of the, what I'm kind of in my mind envisioning, Broadway East. So it's the Arts District, Industrial, Little Tokyo, up to El Pueblo. Lily is Financial, Bunker Hill, South Park side. So you probably won't meet her too much, but yeah. Okay, so at any point, feel free to holler at me.
Great, and you report to the Chief of Staff?
Chief of Staff and Councilman, correct, yeah. And Joelle, how many years did you spend with the Central City?
Oh, sure, sure. So, my background.
She's not new to downtown.
I'm not. I've been in downtown since 2000. I have previously had a marketing and PR event company. The Central City Association was my client for 15 years. A lot of people thought I was employed by them, but I wasn't. So I have a significant background in the lay of the land of the movers and shakers and the issues facing downtown. Okay, thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, so the major part of the meeting here today is kind of a year in review and also some presentations from our maintenance and our safety folks. So,
thank you, Mark. Yes. So I'm very proud to be able to present to you at this annual meeting the work that both our public safety and our maintenance vendors do for us every single day. And just to set a little bit of context, in this past year, we passed a couple of significant milestones. We have hired a brand new maintenance vendor, Chrysalis. We have brought them back after a 10-year absence. They do, I would say, most of the bids in Los Angeles, in addition to a lot of other great work that they do, and I'll explain that to you. The other vendor is our security vendor, and I just wanted to remind you that we also crossed a milestone with them. We've been with Allied Universal for
quite some time. They used to be Universal Protection Services, and they merged with Allied Martin. And during this year of 2017, we also renewed our contract with them for another 2 years. So we are starting 2018 with a great team, and I thought no better opportunity than to have them give you a snapshot of where we are at this point, and I'm very, very proud to have them here to present to you. So with that, Mr. Chair.
All right, so we have from Allied Universal, Greg Foster. So, is Greg?
Good morning, City Manager of the Board. Good morning, City Manager of the Board, our honored guests. My name is Greg Foster. I am the client site manager from Allied Universal. Greg is our executive director, Michelle Lopez, the CCBA. At this time, I'd like to bring my staff in, introduce them all.
Recognize these guys.
Yeah.
Thank you, guys.
Yeah.
Introducing from my far left, Captain Gregory Bascom. He's been with the detail for 12 years now. Captain Bascom provides us with a great deal of oversight in the field, and his presence is always welcome. Next to me is Lieutenant Calero. Lieutenant Calero is in his second year of service. Lieutenant Calero brings with him a great deal of calm and ease in a very difficult situation, which is always beneficial. Next to him is Sergeant Paul Smith. Sergeant Smith is in his 10th year as of 2018 February. Sergeant Smith was also the 2016 Los Angeles City Public Safety Bid Officer of the Year.
Oh,
okay. Thank you, Sergeant Smith. Next to him is Officer Soriano. Mr. Soriano provides us coverage at the dispatch center. Next to Mr. Soriano is Officer Meeks. Officer Meeks is in her first year of service. She brings with her expertise in customer service, which is also beneficial in our environment. Next to her is Officer Lopez. Officer Ray Lopez is with us for his first year. Officer Lopez is also, he also comes with a great deal of benefit. He was a former driver for a courier service, which gives us a great deal of observation inside the field. His keen sense of awareness is paramount. And next to him, our newest member in the field, TR1, who's referred to him as Training One. Mr. Calderon. Mr. Calderon comes to us with a great deal of experience. He has worked in large venues, the Staples Center and Dodger Stadium. Ladies and gentlemen, I present to you our staff of the Public Safety Division. Staff are dismissed. Our color scheme, they are filled with the red shirt.
Okay.
We are now a different color scheme. They are the WID public safety.
Okay, thank you. I
understand.
We're on the change.
As a projector, one just a moment. Give you a little bit about my background. I've been with Allied Universal now for 2 years. I came over. I've been with Allied Universal for 2 years. I was part of the acquisition of ADM. I was at that company for 12 years. I come to the bid with experience in commercial and residential property. This is my first public safety bid management position, excuse me, and I kind of made the approach to, I've never done public safety. So a joke that I had with our executive director was my public access way and being a part of a public safety bid. There's a great deal of challenges that I faced when I first arrived in May of this year. First of all was, what is public safety and what exactly does public safety do? What services does public safety provide to not just the merchants, but the community? So I was tasked to dive in with both feet and get to the bottom of this and find out what can I do to rectify the issues. The first thing that I found out, restructure, reorganization, and resolve. That was the first equation to solve, because when I arrived, I noticed that there were certain operational difficulties and certain inconsistencies were needed to be faced right away. I had to devise a plan that would give our client, as well as the community, the best site of coverage. This being a public safety entity meaning that we operate on the public access ways and easements of city streets. Meaning that in this industry that this is the most volatile and the most difficult public safety division in the country. Having have had that experience that I have in commercial and residential properties, I know that organization and communication were two of the most paramount things that I could do to bring this bid where it needs to be as far as the cohesion is concerned. Creating, cultivating new dynamic operations. That instilled with me to work directly with our executive director, our administrative dispatcher, and my branch management to give me the best observation to be successful. What I did was I devised a plan within the ranks and measures of my staff that every person on this staff needs to have certain attributes. The aptitude and the attitude must be. There was a vetting of officers who were currently on staff who did not meet that criteria. Those staff members were related to other tasks. The restructuring of both the field and classroom training process to reflect the service module and client responsibility. I arrived and I found that there was not enough training that was taking place. The training modules were very vague and very limited. I restructured that so that every officer can have full observation of not just policy and procedure, but protocol as well. The policy and procedure starts in the classroom. It starts with being vetted, it starts with knowing what is expected. I started with a week-long classroom training session. Our pre-screening training test was one page long. By the time I completed my process, that was 7 pages because of the implementation that needed to be added to it in regards to protocol in the field. Not just with call signs, not just with implementing the process, but how did the officer react and respond? I needed to make certain that this was done in a cohesive way and in measures that left nothing to chance. Customer service oriented businesses such as ours need to have one common theme to it, and that is responsibility. I needed to return the team to a sense of responsibility and give them also a sense of ownership. That they and they alone are responsible for their conduct in the field and also the conduct of one another. I did that through a comprehensive study of not just myself being present, but also challenging them to go out into this environment each and every day and provide a service to our community and a service to our merchants. As I said, I arrived in May of 2017, Less than 3 weeks later, implementation of LA Municipal Code 52.34. For those of you who are not familiar with Municipal Code 52.34, please allow me to explain. 52.34 has been on the city books for quite some time, many years. And it was actually implemented in 2001 to cover and govern the public safety bids. After 2000, as of 2001, the city went away from this clause, meaning that public safety bid officers were in fact vendors. So they no longer serve them under this particular municipal code. In turn, the website, I'm sure some of you are familiar with, michaelkohlhaas.org, began to generate documentation that this particular municipal code is not being adhered to by the city of Los Angeles, and it should be. For many, many years, this went on, in and out of regulation. A gentleman by the name of Adrian Risky began to get a bit of momentum and challenged the city in 2016 to have this reinstated. June of 2017, June 1st to be more precise, this municipal code was enacted in full. That day on June 1st, 2017, every public safety bid across the city had to go before the police commission and have every single public safety officer vetted and pass the background check. As you can imagine, that was challenging not just to our particular bid, but to every bid across the city. There was a drop of 30% of personnel staff, but allied accounts. Anything could have kept you from passing that particular background. Anything from a unpaid MTA ticket to a traffic ticket. This particular municipal code was enacted and is now enforced. I'm glad to say that every officer that I have on staff has passed their 2018 permit check, so we have issues going forward. Staffing and retention of officers. From June to December the 8th of this year, I pre-screened 62 potential candidates for public safety, meaning that I brought them in individually, I spoke with them individually to make certain that they fit the criteria that's necessary. Out of those 62 potential candidates, 20 were taken before the police commission. Out of the 20 that were taken before the police commission, 15 of those were presented in a formal interview with our client, meaning that out of the 20, only 15 passed the police commission background check. Out of those 15, I now have 7 current officers on staff, ones of which you met, and I had 1 officer out on medical leave. Our branch office has been monumental and instrumental in helping me provide the coverage for these particular positions that need to be filled. I have gone to several hiring events, which are scheduled by my company, which evidently I'm gonna have one here in 2018. The first one will be in February of next year. Candidate selection process is thorough. Before any of this even gets started with public safety officers, my first step is making sure that all their permits are intact, making certain that they have their background checks also intact before they're even brought over to meet with our client. This is done, and this is a lengthy process. Let me walk you through step by step. I meet with the individual. I assess the individual. After the assessment, I get all the individual's classification documentation. I send that off to the police commission. The police commission then, in 48 to 24 hours, returns that to me. They let me know if this person is clear or if this person has an issue and cannot be vetted by the commission. Now, you can imagine out of 62 people that I have to go, that I've screened, to get 20 possible candidates is not just a long and tedious process, but it's also one that has to take place in order to vet the proper personnel within the system. Our client was gracious enough to give us the incentive so I can attract a better officer and a better caliber of officer. That was monumental for us. Our client's generosity, well received, thus the staff that you saw before you this morning. This is a statistic that doesn't show in the year to date, but I wanted to bring this forward because I think this is very, very important. Merchant contacts. Merchant contacts are where the officer initiates the contact with the merchant because there's been an issue. Maybe it's been someone blocking the sidewalk, maybe it's been someone in his business or her business, and they're refusing to leave. In May of, from May to December 2016, we had 219 merchant contacts. By the same period this year, May to December 2017, we more than doubled that number to 576. This shows that the officers in the field are taking upon themselves to make the contact with the merchants to follow up with their issues, to see if there's anything more that can be done, to see if there's any more assistance that we can provide so that they can be safeguarded in the service that they have. In October of this year, October 30th, we transitioned our service provider for maintenance, Chrysalis. I challenged all my officers at that point to make Chrysalis feel at home, to show good stewardship, and to be good ambassadors, and to give them every generosity that we could. Thus far to this date, the pairing has gone successful, and we look forward to continue working with them. 2018, it's no mistake that my first goal is safety. Again, these officers perform in one of the most volatile and one of the most difficult locations in public safety in our country. I task them every single day to not just go out and provide a service, but to commit themselves to what they do. I'm very proud of them. Service. Service extends beyond just our community. Service extends beyond just to our merchants. Service extends beyond just the individuals that we meet daily on the street. Service is from within. And I tell them that when you leave here, that sense of service should not leave here. It should also go with you. So I impart and I want to empower them as individuals that they themselves can make a difference, not just here, but in their lives and elsewhere. Integrity. Character, integrity, and foremost the responsibility of those things, which are uncompromising. I ask these officers on a daily basis to go out into an environment which I know is going to be challenging, which I know is going to be difficult, in which they understand that, and they do so with a great deal of character, integrity, and sense of responsibility. And lastly, commitment to excellence. Every single day, I meet with my staff at some point, and I ask them, on a daily basis, did you provide today the service that we're contracted to provide to our client? Did you yourself meet the expectation that you were supposed to meet today? My mentorship goes beyond just the 9-to-5 of these individuals. I feel a kinship to them because of what they do on a daily basis and what I ask of them on a daily basis. Therefore, their commitment is paramount. I want them to know that. Thank you for allowing me this opportunity to present to you the 2017 statistics.
Real quick, I have some questions for you. Hours of service for the bid?
Hours of service, sir, are Monday through Friday, 0530 to 19:07 p.m. on the weekend. 07 to 15:30.
Our friends to the west, the Central Associated, Harrison, how many officers would they have on their safety staff? Do we know?
That's a number that I would not know. Currently, our current staff, sir, is that what you're asking?
Our neighbors, the larger bids are less.
The fashion and the DC bid. Well, the DC bid is a 24/7 operation, so I'm going to imagine that they would have probably double that.
Probably about 60 officers.
Yeah, yeah. And our current staff.
From memory, I'm going.
Our current staff is 10. If we're good at full strength, we have 7, 1 out there.
And that of our contract with Allied, any budget?
For next year?
Yeah.
$700,000? Oh, that's total, I think, security. 600 is on the contract, I believe.
Last question. Our only restraint for a larger safety crew is budget?
Yes.
Restraint of the budget. Well, thank you for the work you do. A small staff, but this much space, this environment, wow.
I do want to say, we had coverage for 15, but due to other economic pressures in the marketplace, at the price point that we had set, we were unable to recruit the caliber of officers. So during this year, that's what Greg alluded to, we raised our compensation, and that allowed us to bring in a higher caliber of officer, but it reduced the number of officers. So while we would like to field 15 officers, we do now have a cap of 10 so that we can stay within our budget.
Hard to get into. Here's the biggest part. Took 7 out of 62. A lot of work to do.
Any questions? Greg, I just want to say, you guys do, the work is fantastic, and we really appreciate everything. It's a very, very difficult environment, as you pointed out, probably the most difficult environment anywhere in the city, and perhaps, as you said, even in the United States. So we know the guys work hard and the gals, and it's very much appreciated by everybody in the community. So thank you.
Thank you, sir. Okay. We've got Trevor, Grace, and Joel from Chrysalis. So, come on, guys.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I just want to, while Mr. Foster is there, Chrysalis, we work with currently 16 to 17 bids across the city, and a level of welcome and partnership that we're getting from Mr. Foster is really unparalleled. It's pretty rare. We don't offer a security company, so we just do maintenance, and we tend to partner with Allied more often than anyone else. But it really comes down to the person in charge and their willingness to work this, and it's been fantastic to start. So thank you. Well done. Good job. So my name is Trevor Kale. I wanted to thank you for a couple of things, and have you hear from Joel and Grace a little bit about the specifics. First, I wanted to thank you for my job and for holding us to task in 2007 when we weren't the provider that you needed us to be. They created my position based on the fact that we couldn't retain your business. And I think it was really a turning point for Chrysalis in our organization when we lost your account. We said that's not good enough, and we need to bring in a different level of talent for our businesses. So I started January of 2008, and I've spent my last 10 years really trying to work on creating a maintenance program that does right by our customers and does right by the men and women who come to us for services. Many of you know Chrysalis is a nonprofit organization. We help men and women coming out of homelessness. A big majority of our employees are out of this community that we're in right here. They come to us for a work opportunity. They work for us for up to 12 months, gaining self-esteem and the work habits that you and I have probably either taken for granted or kind of known our whole life, and they haven't been able to. And after that period, then they're ready to go out to work in the larger employment marketplace. But we really needed to supply the bid with the kind of responsive services and clean services that they demanded. And then the second reason I want to thank you is for trusting us 10 years later. I believe we are an organization now who is prepared to meet your needs and keep you happy. And if that is not the case, I'm here to commit to you that we will do whatever we can to make that happen. And with that, I'll let Grace and Joel kind of talk to you about what we've done so far. We started in, I believe, October 30th was day one, so it's been a quick get up to speed.
And thank you. Thanks for having us today, and more importantly, thanks for giving our men and women the chance to be in this district. When we first got the request for a proposal, I thought, wow, industrial district is our backyard, we've got to go after it. But it You don't know what it's going to be like until you actually get here. It was all that we thought it might be and more. So you lived up to the expectations, but I hope that we've lived up to the expectations that you've had for us. So we started on October 30, we did the blitz. We had 6 trucks racing around this district trying to make way of what's north and south. We had 24 workers. We brought in a bunch of extra supervisors as well, just to kind of get a lay of the land and figure out how are we going to move this much trash. We overstaffed and committed some of our own resources as we kind of continue to figure out in that first couple weeks what's it going to take to do this well. And then now we're up and running. And we are led by James Blackwell, is the name of the supervisor here. He has been fantastic. He's been with us for a number of years before coming to this contract. And so he's been our point person, but both Grace and I have been here many a morning at 6 a.m. to make sure the launch goes right and everybody has supplies. Just whenever you're starting a new contract, there's going to be new challenges. What's the life of this contract like with this business improvement district? And so one of the things that stood out to us is the level of trash on Mondays, right? What are Mondays like? And so how do we adjust for that and shifting schedules and that sort of stuff to best address the needs that you guys have? Our ongoing schedule, just as a quick refresher, Monday through Friday, we're running from 6 a.m. to 3 p.m. On Mondays, we're a little heavier staffed and taper down on Friday as we've sort of gotten our bearings over the course of the week. And then on Saturdays, there's 2 different trucks with driver assistants who are out there just trying to address all the service calls. Other things that we've learned is that you have a fantastic team here with Estella and Jesse. I just want to say a huge thank you to the two of you for setting the stage so well for us to come in and be as successful as we can. So working with you guys, just knowing that Estella is a true advocate for us. She's out there and has our back. Our workers trust her, James, our supervisor does, as well as Grace and me. So thank you to Estella. And Jesse, anytime you're starting a new contract, there are so many details, and Jesse knows all of them. So that download of knowledge was huge for us. So thanks, and also to Mr. Foster. Few contracts have as good of a relationship with the security vendor as what we have here. So, you know, we did have one security incident in the first 2 weeks, and just one of our workers pushing her cart, and she had an incident with someone, and safety was there in under 2 minutes. Immediately responding, our worker was safe, everything ended up being fine. But just right off the bat, to build that trust together, I think was huge for our team. And to know that, hey, if something comes up, Industrial has our back. So thank you to all of you.
I just want to spend a minute. I put one of our monthly reports behind everyone's packet. If you don't have them, I have more. But this is something you guys are going to be getting every month. And so this month you can kind of see it only has the data since, you know, we've been here in November. So over time, this is going to be less week by week information, and it's going to be month by month comparing, getting to the point of comparing year after year to see how trends, what trends show up. But you've got some statistics up at the top and some graphs kind of showing, again, this is by week. So you can see that the last week of November was the one with most trash, most calls. That's a large part because of Thanksgiving, and as you guys know, a lot of the giveaways and things that are happening that long weekend. And then the second page and third page are purely before and after photos. We'll always do kind of a compilation of some of them so you guys can get a little taste. I mean, we know you guys live it. You see it out there, but some of the stuff that we do, and as you can see here, these are a couple of our before and after photos as well. The top two being from Thanksgiving weekend. Wow. Does anyone have any questions on any of the report or what it is that we're tracking? You can always let me know. Again, as we go with the month to month, you'll get more data and we can start to see what months are worse.
Remarkable amount of trash.
Yes.
Yeah. Was it more than you had anticipated when coming on, or were you surprised?
Yeah, there was some surprise. We had to come up with new ways to get that much trash out of the sidewalk, right? And so creating b- buying new trash cans that we've never done, and customizing trash cans, just to figure out how can we move through this district as quick as possible. So, yeah, there's some different challenges. We worked closely with Estella this last month with some of the flower shops and trying to figure out how to best manage some of that trash as well, so.
I think we were surprised in a couple of different ways. One, our primary concern coming in and bidding on this was security of our workforce. And I think that's mostly been, like, we feel like we've got a good handle, we've got a good partner, and we also have this uprising from the community of, like, they're just grateful, and they see that we're coming and cleaning, so we're getting, from the street population, we're actually getting a really good response. And I think the volume of trash and how we can move quickly was, we knew that there was trash, but just, it's there 5 minutes after you're.
How do you protect your team from Pat Bay?
So we've got a number of ways that we train folks up front, personal protective equipment, if there's training that goes on, it's, fortunately, everything that we had already built in when you're running a trash business are the same protections that protect you from Pat Bay. So the way that we keep people safe didn't have to change because it's so important that you're not making that type of contact while you're out there.
We also did have a Pat Bay shot that was offered to every employee at Chrysalis, including our field ops staff. So we posted that at the Chrysalis Enterprise office on 5th of May.
For what it's worth, my doctor insisted I get the vaccination.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I did, but yeah. I never thought about it.
Mm-hmm. Just operationally, another shout out to both Estella and Jesse. Jesse answers my calls anytime I need him, and all of my team's calls. It's truly amazing, the response time.
How important it is. You've got to be good partners with ourselves and the whole team is sensitive to it. So we appreciate the work you're doing and also the challenges of the two-way street.
Yeah, I had noticed that the blitz, you guys were definitely on force, and that was great to see. This area is just so overwhelmed that I have no idea. I can only imagine what it would look like if we didn't have you guys doing the work that you do out in the world. It's so difficult just to keep the area at bay, let alone this time of year as well. So very much appreciate you guys doing a great job, very much appreciate it. And I'll tell you, for me personally, I've said this to you before, and I think this echoes what everybody else feels as well regarding the staff that you're using. I think it's, to me, this is such a win-win because we get the benefit of trying to keep our area clean and at the same time providing opportunities for those who want to take the next step in improving their lot in life. And I think that, to me, that's just such a perfect type of system. So I think it's great. I'm glad to have that. So thank you.
Thank you, everyone. Appreciate it.
All right, Ken, it's time for you.
Okay. November, we're pretty much in line with our budget overall, a little bit under in security, a little bit over in maintenance between the two, roughly right on budget. I think we'll be a little bit over budget in December, which is fine. We should be actually at the year end because we were a little under budget year to date. So we'll see some increased costs in December. We also have some accruals built in that won't get paid until January and February. We had low delinquency rate this year, as you know, we have had in the past few years now, so we're doing well there on our contingency and delinquency. We ended the month with about $700,000 in the bank. We have probably another $400,000 or so of expenses that we'll cover for year end. Again, it'll be in December, it'll be in January, it'll be in February. We don't know all of the costs until we get all of the invoices that are related to the 2017 year. But we do anticipate that we'll have cash in the bank at the end of the year. We do have new contracts for security and maintenance in line. We've increased those for 2018, and we'll have some carryover funds to help to cover for those costs as well. So overall, from a financial statement, from a financial position, we're doing very well. We do have cash in the bank. We do have our carryover funds going into next year. We are going to be able to
increase the services for next year because of those carryover funds. And that's where we end up for the year. Yeah, we're in good shape. We saved money at the beginning of the year, now we're putting it into services at the end of the year and going into next year.
Which is editorial, we're in good shape for the smallest budget possible.
Right.
It should be three times, it's four times.
Yeah, I mean, knowing the amount of security that's available in other bids.
Well, we did not raise, remember last, we did not raise the.
We didn't raise any assessment fees.
We've maintained, I think, pretty consistent conservative approach on assessments.
We've done a tight budget this year, we're really good.
Any questions? Appreciate it, thank you.
Sure.
Let us talk.
Okay, thank you very much. So in addition to Chrysalis's report, their statistics for the month, you'll have in your package as well the year in review for both security and maintenance. I wanted to bring one thing to your attention that Chrysalis didn't mention. They are also in charge of our pressure wash services. And I'd like to bring your attention to the November statistic on that. You can see how the numbers have gradually increased throughout the year. Look at November, 241 requests for pressure wash. Let me tell you why that's significant. First of all, it's the one request that we fulfill. It's on a request-only basis. We have our maintenance teams out there cleaning up all the time. But if someone has in front of their business something that requires a pressure wash, and these are usually, you know, bodily fluids, and something that has to be addressed immediately, that's a rapid response request. And we dispatch those calls, obviously, and they carry a great deal of importance when they come in. But also, I think, to Chrysalis's credit, the visibility that we have on the street now, more people, brighter uniforms, we're getting flagged down, we're getting many, many more merchants know that we are available and that we do provide that service. Combined with that, Greg mentioned in his report that we've pretty much doubled our merchant requests. Our security is much more proactive in making their presence known. When they're not actively responding to a call, they are making merchant contacts. So those two streams together have aided us in giving us a higher profile and reminding folks who we are and what we do. And much of that has been reflected in these statistics. And again, the pressure wash request is one of those that we are offering a great deal of customer satisfaction. In spite of the conditions on the street, that is one very real and very tangible rapid response that without the bid you wouldn't have. So I did want to point that out to you. The other thing, and Chrysalis did mention this a little bit, is the green waste. We have a tiny portion of our district that the flower district comes across San Pedro Street here between 7th and 8th. That tiny spillover of flower shops has been a, pardon the pun, thorn in our side. Several times a year, certain holidays where people buy flowers, these businesses throw an inordinate amount of green waste out into the street. One, they either don't have or they have inadequate refuse service. And B, they've just been conditioned to throw this green waste out into the street. Last Mother's Day, one block, one day, we collected 5 tons of trash. Mm. So that's not sustainable. I reached out to the city, and you know, it's not always easy to get the city to respond either because their resources are inadequate as well. But on this one particular case, I have to give the city a tremendous amount of credit. The Bureau of Sanitation, along with the new company that's got the franchise for downtown, they formed a task force, and they have been meeting with us for over 2 months here in this room consistently and going out with our team, and in fact, even working with our team, going in our trucks and performing surprise visits, almost like sting operations, and catching people in the act of throwing trash out onto the street. We ramped that up before December so that we would get a handle on it before the December holidays. And I can report to you that working with the Bureau of Sanitation, the private company NASA, and our teams, we saw this past week when one of those holidays, which may not be familiar to you, but in the Hispanic community, the feast day of Our Lady of Guadalupe is like Christmas. And that's one of the times when we see this tremendous illegal dumping of green waste. The merchants were warned weeks in advance. Some were cited, some were caught in these sting operations. NASA signed them up for refuse, and, right? Everyone behaved. Trash is, and our security also had to be on the lookout to make sure that they weren't taking their bags of trash, which they've done before, and taking them two or three blocks down and throwing them there. So it was an all-out effort by both security, maintenance, the city, and the private contractor, and we have made a difference. So that was a huge thing that certainly gave us a sense of accomplishment. The other thing was that during Thanksgiving weekend, when we normally don't have the resources more than what we normally have, because of the little bit of cushion that we had in our budget, I was able to place people more security and maintenance on the street that weekend, both Saturday and Sunday. And we were able to pick up trash that would have been left for Monday, which would have meant that we probably wouldn't have got the streets clean for 2 days after Thanksgiving, at least. So that was another win this year that kind of goes beyond these numbers. So again, credit to both security and maintenance to helping us to be able to do that. So that's that. Other things that have happened this year, since our last meeting. At the last meeting, you know that our city controller was here, and he did offer to have a separate meeting with us to do a more thorough deep dive on the issue of encampments, and he did that report. They have not yet scheduled that meeting. I will let you know when they do. But they said that they are going to follow up on it. They just couldn't do it as quickly as before the end of the year. I attended last week a conference by the Urban Land Institute. They had an expert panel here for a week looking at the issue of street encampments. These were people from throughout the country, no one from Los Angeles or California, former mayors, former city managers from different parts of the country. Obviously, their mandate is to look at it from a land use perspective, and so most of their recommendations at the end of the week have to do with building more affordable housing. They interviewed every city council member, the city attorney, someone I believe from the mayor's office, and a number of us that deal with this issue every single day. And I will get a hold of their final report. It's going to be posted on the ULI website. But one of the things that I found very encouraging was that they ventured a little bit out of their scope of land use and actually have a recommendation. And Bobby, I know you've talked a lot about this. One of their key recommendations is that the city of Los Angeles cannot allow the continuation of street encampments in the way that they are today, and that the city immediately has to access city land or nonprofit land and get these people off the sidewalk and in safety with the facilities that they need for hygiene, for medical evaluation, for mental health services. Obviously, you know, these are folks from out of town. They're not aware of the litigations and the things that are part of the LA fabric in dealing with that. It doesn't make it that easy. But certainly there was a call to action from ULI that the city of Los Angeles cannot continue to allow the status quo. So I'll let you know when those recommendations are in the public realm. And then just the day-to-day issues. Now, in addition to human waste on the sidewalk, we're dealing with dog waste. Mm-hmm. Many more encampments have dogs, and we're having to deal with that as well.
Are we picking up human waste as part of our job?
Well, certainly pressure washing deals with that. And then I do know of at least one location where the encampments use buckets and then place the buckets next to the trash cans that we pick up. But I'll let Joel or Grace talk a little bit more about that.
Every day, all day.
Anywhere we see it. If it's on the sidewalk, we don't want to step in it, so we take care of it. All of our carts have a little thing of water on them so that they can kind of throw a little bit down after they pick it up. But for the bad ones, you know, it's the pressure washing is what we use.
We've had more incidents of this in the city arts the last 2 or 3 months than I ever recall. Mm-hmm.
We pick up.
That's Hepe. That's where Hepe is based.
Now, to be fair, the city just opened their hygiene center just a couple of blocks away from here. Unfortunately, it's not open 24/7. It's only open 4 days a week for limited hours. They have said that they want to increase the service after the first of the year, but that's all they have at the moment.
Got to hold it until
then. Sad, yeah. Anyway, last but not least, I just want to add my thanks first and foremost to all of you for your continued support and advice this year. As always, you're the ones who walk the walk, not just talk the talk. And I just have a great deal of respect for each and every one of you and those board members who aren't present today for inspiring me to do my best job every single day that I can. But I stand on the shoulders of the people who gave the reports today. Greg, Grace, Joel, Trevor. They are the ones who make me look good. And I certainly do count more than I can ever say on the help, assistance, and enormous sense of humor that keeps me going every day from that guy back there, Jesse Jimenez. Thank you, Jesse. That's my report.
That's it. Any other questions for me?